So sometimes, we have seen in the past, that sometimes it is necessary to elaborate the answer also, but here the answer is given right away, and kahola kaushitakeya, he is satisfied, and thus he becomes silent. In the beginning, Mahasyakara says that the reason why kahola kaushitakeya just repeats the question of Ushastra Chakraya is to know some tasmad bhinna vayava atmano kshetrajna parma, no, tasmad, etasyeva drishyavam vishesha vivakshaya. Page 795, the conclusion is ekasyeva drishyavam, ekasyeva atmanah drishyavam. One atma alone is asked of twice, you know. Why? Vishesha vivakshaya. Some vishesha, some further vishesha or some further characteristic is to be known. Something more is to be known. That is why vivakshaya, with that desire to know something more, that this question is repeated here. What made you conclude that? Eshadatma. In each case, Yajnavalkya replies, Eshadatma sarvantaraha. So, to both Ushastra and Kahola, to both of them, Yajnavalkya says, Eshadatma sarvantaraha. Te atma. Tava karyakana sanghadasya atma sarvantaraha. He Ushastra, he Kahola, the atma you are asking about is the atma, the self of this karyakana sanghada, the gross and the subtle body. Then Vashyakara says, that shows that there is only one entity, because there cannot be two atmas in this karyakana sanghara. Somebody said, maybe the atma of Ushastra is the one that is discussed in the fourth Brahma, and atma of Kahula is different discussed in fifth Brahma. He says, no, atmas cannot be different also. So it cannot be that Ushastra is one kind of an atma, and Kahula is another kind of an atma, because what is the distinguishable one atma from the other atma? And so, tava atma, that shows that is one atma alone that is referred to. It is from the reply that we know. Question is one alone, the reply also is the same. Although then there are certain more specifics are added subsequently, but basically, eshabaya atma sarvantaraha. So the one that we are talking about is yourself, is the self of this karyakana sanghata, and that alone is sarvantara svakshat aparokshat brahma. That being the case, it is the same atma who is being discussed here also. Otherwise, if, let us say, that the Atma talked about in the fourth Brahmana is different than the Atma talked about in the fifth Brahmana, then both the Atmas are what? Sarvantara means Sakshad, Aparokshad, Brahma, Atma, Sarvantara, both of them. The two Atmas are different. Both of them cannot be Sakshad. Both of them cannot be Aparokshad. Both of them cannot be Sarvatma. Both of them cannot be Brahman. Because all of these, the Sakshad and Aparokshad and Brahma can only be one, Sarvandara can be one. There cannot be two of them. In which case we have to say that one of the Atma is Sarvandara, other one is not Sarvandara. In which case then to say that your Atma, Sarvandara, that would not be right. And thus Bhashyakara concludes that this Brahmana also refers to the same entity about which earlier Brahmana was the subject matter. And anuvada. Anuvada means reiteration, repeating. Up to this point, eshadatma sarvantara katamo yajnivalga sarvantara. Up to this point alone the repetition is there. Not beyond that. We said that beyond that the passages are different, because each passage says something specific about the atma. So second passage here, the fifth brahmana, is meant to say something specific thing which was not said in the fourth brahmana. So Kahola found that Ushastra was unnecessarily satisfied with the answer. Kahola thought that Yajnavalkya did not do justice, you know, in the fourth, in replying to Ushastra. Yajnavalkya replied, and Ushastra became silent, and Kahola was upset about it. Why did he become silent? In fact, Yajnavalkya has not done justice, and therefore not actually enfolded the Atma in its entirety, and therefore he raised that question. That's another way of looking at it also. Alright, suppose you say that there is something, some more specifics are to be said. What is it? Ucchate, page 795, second line, Ucchate, purvasmin prasne, asti vyatirikta atma, yasyayam sap prayojakah bandha uktahiti. Purvasmin prasne, in the fourth brahmana, asti vyatirikta atma, there is an atma Vyatirikta means Karyakana Sanghara Vyatirikta. The very one Atma above and beyond the Karyakana Sanghara. And as you said yesterday, why is it necessary to say? Because this Karya, the body is the Atma that everybody knows. Karana, the subtle body is the Atma that also everybody knows. And that's all people know. Therefore, Shruti says, there is an Atma above and beyond them. Now, these are Atma all right, but they are not just, Atma is not them. These are Atma all right in as much as, yes, they are Atma, but Atma is not them, meaning Atma is not confined to them. And that Atma is samsari. The Karyakana Sanghara is not samsari. Who is samsari? That Atma is samsari. Yasyam sapayodako bandhakaha bandhavuktaha. It is that Atma about whom this bandha, bondage, saprayojaka, along with karma and all of that was stated in earlier brahmanas. Dvidiyetu tasyeva atma ashanayari samsara dharmadi tattvam vishesha uchyate. Dvidiyet, meaning in the fifth brahmana now, tasyeva atma, the same atma ashanayari samsara dharmadi tattvam vishesha. That atma is ashanayari samsara dharma atitaha. Atma transcends the samsara dharma. This samsara dharma is what makes a samsari. Who is the samsari? Ashanayavan, pipasavan. And what is the shoka grastaha, murha, martyaha. So this is the samsari. And so the one that transcends all the dharma of the samsara, that atma is inside the one, he is samsari all right, but he transcends all the samsara dharma. Meaning he transmigrates all right, but the transmigration is due to ignorance and not because it's jara, mrityu, shoka, moha, the really the nature of the atma, but because of ignorance he transmigrates. Asanayari samsara dharmadi tattvam vishesha uchare. What for? Yad vishesha parijnanat sa sanyasa sahitat puroktat bandhana vimuchare. Only when this vishesha is known, that atma is asanayari atidaha, then. And again, when that knowledge is accompanied with samsara, then alone one becomes liberated from the bondage. Tasmat prasna pratyavachanayoho eshadatma ityavantayoho tulyasadayoho. And therefore, of the question and the answer, up to this point, eshadatma sarvantaraha, it is the same entity. Then the question is, how can one Atma have these two kinds of characteristics? We experience Atma as Ashanaya Pipasavan. I know that I am endowed with hunger and thirst and old age and death and whatever else. And Shruti says that Atma is beyond old age and death. How can it be that one Atma has these two kinds of characteristics? Is it that after I get liberated that I become free from hunger and thirst? And that as long as I am bound and so long really I am endowed with hunger and thirst and then I get liberated from that? That means that mukti or the liberation, does it bring about a real change in Atma? And that is how the liberated person is beyond the hunger and thirst? It says, no, not so. Nāmaru vikāra kārikāra lakṣana saṅghāta upādhi bheda samparga janita bhanti mātrami samsāyatma jasakrit avocāna. Second line, page 796. Nāmaru vikāra kārikāra lakṣana saṅghāta. Nāmaru vikāra. So name and form of which vikara is Karyakana Sanghata. It's interesting what Bhashyakara says is, Karyakana Sanghata is a modification of Nama and Rupa. So Nama Rupa becomes a conceptual thing. Nama Rupa is a concept which really becomes solidified or becomes tangible in the form of this Karyakana Sanghata. So idea is that before actual Karyakana Sanghata, the tangible Karyakana Sanghata is there, it is in a conceptual form, which is what we call the Nama Rupa. Otherwise, we generally say that Nama is a concept and the Rupa is the actual manifestation of that concept. But here, Bhashyakara says Nama Rupa Vikara. And Anandagiri also explains Tayoho Vikara Karya Karana Lakshana Sanghata. So anyway, this Karya Karana Sanghata, which is a Vikara, that alone is upadhi. That is upadhi. That is a limiting adjunct, you know. So upadhi bheda samparga janita bhranti matram. That upadhi, this karyakana sanghata brings about all the bheda, brings about all the duality. Because one karyakana sanghata is different from the other one. And so the sense of smallness and the distinctiveness comes out because of this identification with the upadhi. And that's all. Upadhi samparga janita bhranti matram samsaritvam. Samsaritva, the state of being samsari, is nothing but the identification of the upadhi, which is of the nature of karyakarana sanghata, and that is all samsarikam. Idea is that the fact that I think that I am hungry and thirsty or I am a samsari is a notion born of the identification with the upadhi, and not that it is the real nature of the atma. Therefore, both are all right. When you say that atma is samsari, that also is all right. From which standpoint? From the standpoint of Brahma. When you say atma is rasanaya the atita, that also is all right. That is with reference to the paramasika, the true nature of the atma. And therefore, nachevam. It's interesting how one atma is alone is referred to as samsari as well as a samsari. Nachevam. Virudhana samvayitve padarthanam kaschana virodaha. And therefore, it is vidya and avidya because of which this kind of distinctions are there. Atma is called samsari when there is vidya. Avidya is called asamsari when there is vidya. So therefore, one thing can be said to be more than one thing can be referred to as possessing contradictory characteristics. Like what is called rope also is called snake. How can one thing can be called rope and snake? Both. Ignorance, it is snake. Knowledge, it is rope. Not that knowledge brings about a real change in this entity and that what was snake becomes rope. No. What was thought to be snake is now discovered to be rope. Oh, that means that now you are saying there is an upadhi. This karyakarana sanghata upadhi is there. Atma is also is there. That means that you are accepting the existence of two entities. One is atma, who is dashanayadi rahitaha, and other is the karyakarana sanghata, the upadhi. And you are saying that because of identification of the upadhi, the atma experiences or feels the sense of limitation. That upadhi is something different from the atma. Atma is one entity, upadhi is another entity. Na upa upadhyastitve ekamevadvitiyam nehananastakinchanivishrutaya virudhyeran. Then you are, the Upanishad says ekamevadvitiyam, atma is one without a second. Atma does not stand a second, means divided of any kind at all. Nehananastakinchan, there is no duality here whatever. And here you are accepting duality. He says, no, we accept it, sort of accept it, but not really accept it. He said yesterday that Atma can be our Sakshi to begin with. To bring our attention from the Karyakarana Sanghata to the Self, we say Atma is Drashta or Sprashta or Sakshi. Ultimately we recognize that in the dimension of Sakshi, everything is included. Sakshi is not the one here that stands separate from the Sakshya, but Sakshya is the one that includes the Sakshya. Drashta is not the one here that stands separate from Drashya, but that which encompasses the Drashya. And therefore, Drashya does not stand separate from Drashta. Even though Drashta can obtain independent of Drashya, Drashya cannot obtain independent of Drashta. In that sense, there is no duality. There cannot be duality between Satyam and Mithya. Atma is satya, upadhi is mithya. So just as I can be there, and number of my reflections can be there, and still that does not make a call, that does not really create a duality, because all the reflections are mithya, and therefore they cannot be counted separately. Sarirfena dushtantena, bhashyakara korzo dushtanta parihrtatvat, mrudadi dushtanta isya. That from one pind of one lump of clay, that number of parts are made. Just because parts appear to be many, doesn't mean that there is manyness. In fact, there is oneness alone with reference to clay. And there appears to be manyness with reference to name and form, but those names and forms do not have any reality of their own. There is no tangibility in name and form. Yadādu paramātha duṣṭyā paramātha tattvāt śrutyanusārivihi anyatve nirūpyamāyana rūpe mṛdādi vikāra vastvantare tattvato nastaha salilufena ghatādi vikāra vadeva sādapeksha ekamevādvitiyam nihanānāsti kinchanityādi paramātha asana gosaratvam pratipadyate yadādu paramātha duṣṭyā. So this salila, the water and the foam and all of these, when they are looked at from the paramātha duṣṭyā, from the reality that they are, you can call it foam and you can call it bubble and you can call it wave, all these names are there paramātha duṣṭyā, but when you know, really look at it from what they are, then all of them are found to be nothing but water. Otherwise, pots and pitchers and so forth, when you are really... So, Vedanta deals with only the reality. Not with, well, the pot looks different and pitcher is different, they are all different. The pot performs a different function and pitcher also performs a different function. We all accept it. Vedanta respects all those differences also. So, without rejecting the differences, Vedanta tells us that in spite of the differences obtaining at a given level, which is called nama, rupa or mithya, that even then, that this duality obtaining at the level of nama, rupa does not deny the non-duality, which is the true nature. Tada, tadapeksha, and similarly also, when all the names and forms that we experience, including our own self, when the reality about them is determined, then you find that all these names and forms, all these dualities, all of them ultimately get reduced, not in a physical sense. Now that reduction is in the level of the mind. It's not that the duality reduces to oneness in a physical sense. It doesn't have to. It is not that all the parts have to really get broken and merge into clay. But then, that parts reducing to clay, that step takes place in the intellect. When we determine what we call the degree of reality of the pot, which is mithya, and the clay, which is satyam, mrittikeityo satyam, then all these parts, they ultimately reduce to one thing, that is clay. And similarly also, the whole existence, with good, bad and indifferent, whatever that is, all the paramanatha dushtya, paramanatha dasana gocharatvam pratipadyate, and then these statements make sense. Until then they don't make sense. Neha nanasti kinchana, ekameva advityam, all of these really make sense to the one who is able to do this, who is able to actually reduce all this duality into one. So prasadbhavam ekasthaman pasyate tateva cha svistara brahma sampadyate tada. All the prasadbhavam, all this duality actually emerges from one, and it ultimately merges into one, emerges from one and merges into one, when one sees. How do you see that? Not as you say in the physical sense, but when in the mind I determine the reality of the name and form, which are not apart from the thought anyway, and the thought itself arises from the consciousness and merges back into consciousness, and even when it is there, it's bathing in the consciousness alone. And this I realize that the consciousness, the thought, is world, and the duality, the consciousness is that which imparts the satta and this food into this thought. Then I realize. So first I determine that what is perceived, the world, is not separate from the thought. And the thought is not separate from the consciousness, which is a self. And therefore, we do not accept the duality, meaning that upadhi does not enjoy a degree of reality which is the same as the upahita atma. Then why this laukika vyavahara? Why this vyavahara of duality? Page 798, yadatu svabhavikya avidya brahma swarupam rajya shuktika gagana swarupodeva svena rupena vasamanam kenachit asprashta svabhava visata na rupakrit karyakarana upadibhya vivekena navadharyate. Vivekena navadharyate. Just as when one is not able to actually distinguish the snake from the rope, and so also one is not able to do the viveka between the clay and the pot, or between nama rupa and the self. So thinking that the pot is separate from clay, thinking that the snake is separate from the rope, thinking that the, or concluding that the name and form is separate from the Satchit Ananda. Nama rupa krita karyakaranopadibhya vivekena navadharyate. When one fails to see, this nama rupa is nothing but a tangible manifestation of one sat, asti bhavi priyam. That one asti alone becomes this nama rupa, and then bhati it shines, and then alone because it reflects the atma, therefore it is priyam. So one sat alone manifests as nama rupa, and since sat is self-effulgent, therefore it shines. And since it is a reflection of Satchit Atma, therefore, it is priyam. And so, when to the mind, if the characteristic of the peculiarity of the Nama Rupa does not matter, as long as Nama Rupa is important, as long as how the Nama Rupa is important, so long the Asti Bhavi Priyam doesn't gain its importance. When Nama Rupa doesn't matter, in the sense of whatever it is fine. Doesn't matter, doesn't mean that one is indifferent to that, doesn't matter what it is. After all, it's Nama Rupa. It doesn't matter what's the wrapper, you know, what's the big deal about it. What's important is the candy, that's in the wrapper. That reminds me that we should, you know, bring it, this candy is one day here, you know, so everybody can have it. Anyway, and so what matters is just the candy. But when one, you know, quarrels about the wrappers, then poor candy does not gain the due importance. And similarly also, but Swamiji, this is not wrapper, this is the tangible stuff. What are you talking about? Just because you give an example of wrapper, so on, you know. But it is true. To a child, it is not an ordinary thing. To a child, that yellow wrapper is different from a red wrapper, and then he would not settle for anything other than yellow. Other child will not settle for anything other than blue. It is true that what is unimportant from a given standpoint for a certain mind can be extremely important for some other mind, you know. So it's more a mindset rather than whether it is important or not. So there can be a mindset. There are five children, you know, and for mother or father or whatever, I mean, all of them could be one, regardless of what differences there are. And still one can see the oneness in them and be able to relate to them. But not to each one of them or not to somebody else. And the idea is that it is just as Vedanta Sara says that all these trees look individual trees and all the distinctions are evident as long as I am at the level of the earth. When I rise up to the sky and look at all the trees, then I can see the tree-ness. Now, it's a tree-ness that manifests itself as tree, that's all. But that tree-ness I lose sight of. When the individual characteristics of the tree are important to me, then one loses sight of the tree-ness. It's necessary to rise above. So, walking on the ground is nothing but identifying with this ground reality of the karyakara sanghata. And when one can rise above that, then one can see that after all, what is that? It may be a people tree or a neem tree, but ultimately one tree-ness manifests as different things. Then the variety becomes a source of joy. That very variety has become a big problem. The variety of the duality with a tremendous problem then becomes a source of pleasure. When one can see what is there above and beyond the variety. Not until then. So upadibhya vivekena navadharyate nāma-rūpādi dṛṣṭihe vacca bhavati. One becomes only confined to the reality of nāma-rūpa and nothing else. Svabhāviki tadā sarvayam vastvantarāstitva vyavhāraha. Then yes, this vyavhāra, that there is another vastu called ātmā and anātmā and jīva bheda and jīva and jagat bheda and jagat and īśvara bheda and jīva and īśvara bheda. All these bhedas are there. Yes, this is all there. So Vedāntins explain all this vyavahara of duality by this prakriya of ajñānam. This is a standard prakriya. It's a model. Ignorance bringing about the adhyāropa, identification, and that bringing about the sense of individuality, giving reality to nāma-rūpa, giving rise to the sense of individuality, and then giving rise to the reality to the vyavahara of duality. Asti chayam bheda krito mithya vyavaharaha yesham brahma tattvat anyatven vastu vidyate. And therefore, for those for whom there is vastu other than brahma tattva, the nama rupa is a vastu other than brahma, for them, yes, this vyavahara of duality is there, very much there. Yesham chanasti. How about the wise people? For in whose vision there is only one vastu, namely brahma, do they have any vyavahara as far as the duality is concerned? They also have. Except that, in the vision, that vastvantaratvam is not there. The point is not so much the vyavahara as much as what is it that actually prompts the vyavahara. Where is the origination of vyavahara? As far as wise people are concerned, the vyavahara of duality is there, but that vyavahara originates from the knowledge of non-duality. The idea is that knowledge of non-duality is not opposed to the vyavahara of duality. So just because we see the vyavahara of duality does not mean that the duality is real. So even for the vivekis also there is vyavahara in the realm of duality, but in the vision that duality is not real. For the avivekis, the vyavahara in the duality arises from the real duality in the mind between the vastu and the avastu. It's not avastu. For them, nama-rupa also is vastu. Paramarthavadivistu shrutyanusarena nirupyamane vastuni. Paramarthavadi. Those fellows who are, identified with the shruti, karma, that's the only way to resolve things. This is not the way of resolving things. No way whatever. As long as nama-rupa is given reality, there is no way to solve any problem in the world. We can make adjustments all right here and there, but no way anything can be solved. And adjustments are required, you require relief, you require all that, but we don't deny that. We can avoid the problem, we can get away from it, avoiding can be done, which is also required, we require that. But no way the problem can be solved unless one rises, grows out of that. Paramatvadivistu shrutyanusarena nirupyamane vastuni. So they do the nirupana vastu according to shruti, not according to their present understanding, but they do the ascertainment of the vastu with reference to the vision of the shruti. Kim tattvada asti vastu kim vana asti iti. Is there a vastu in reality, nama rupa or not? Brahma ekam eva advitiyam sarasamvihara shunyam vastu asti iti na. Or that Brahman which is beyond all the vyavahara, is such a thing there or not? So, vastu, what is the nature of the vastu? And then when they come to this nirnaya, that yes, Brahma is vastu, vastu is only Brahman, sarva samvyavahara shunyam, meaning that which is untouched by the vyavahara of the duality, iti nirdhayate, when they determine that this is the vastu, tena na kasyat virodha, and therefore, this is how it is, so their vyavahara of the duality is not contradicted. Your wife people also seem to do the same thing that everybody else does. That's okay. It is not the doing that determines as much as knowing that determines. Nahi paramartha avadharana nishthayam vastvantara astitvam pratipadyamahe ekamevadvitiyam anantaram vahyam adishrutehe. That for them, this vastu other than Brahman is not there. Nasanaurupa vyavahara kale tu avivekinam kriyakaraka phalada samyaha naste iti pratishidhyate. We don't say that the avivekis, they do not go through what they are going through, or that the problems are not there in the life, we do not say. Except that the origination of all the problems is because of the lack of viveka, this is what we have to say. But yes, kriyakaraka phalada samyavahara hasti, they also perform kriya, employing karakas for getting phala, and then gaining experience, then transmigrating, all of that stuff is there. Idina pradeshidyade, we do not deny that, but all of that is a product of the avivekha. Tasmad jnana jnana apeksha sarvaha samvivaharaha shastriyaha laukikasya. All the vivahara shastriya and the laukika is jnana ajnana apeksha. The wise people, they function from the platform of jnanam. The otherwise people function from the platform of ajnanam. Ataha na kachana virodha shanka, and therefore that one atma can be thought of contradictory because of lack of viveka and presence of viveka is not a contradiction. So this is the paramartha drishti. Tatra paramartha atma surovaveksha prashnaha punaha. So when kahola kaushitake asks, katho yajnavalkya sarvantara iti, hey Yajnavalkya, which one of them is sarvantara? Which one is sakshat aparokshat brahma sarvantara atma? Which one? This karya, this body, or the karana, this subtle body, or the third one, which one? And so actually kahola kaushitaka is asking for that paramartha vastu. And so then Sri Yajnavalkya replied, ya ashnaya vipase sukam moham jaram mrityum atyedi. The one that transcends ashnaya vipasa, the hunger and thirst. The idea is that one thing that atma is possessed of hunger and thirst is because of not being able to distinguish where hunger and thirst belong. The hunger and thirst is there. Where is it? At the level of upadhi. Shoka moha also may be there at the level of upadhi. Jaramrutyu also is at the level of upadhi. So jaramrutyu, the decrepited old, death is the nature of the characteristic of the body, gross body. The hunger and thirst of the prana. The shokamoha of the mind. At this level, these things are there. But, yete ashanadaya pramana sariradhikaranaha space 801 praneshu anavartam vartamanaha ahoratradivat samudravam vachya praneshu samsari uchyate. So this urmaya, all these urmis means different waves are there in samsara sagara. The body is one wave, prana is another wave, mind is the third wave. Or this old age and death, or death, birth and death, and the hunger and thirst, and the grief and delusion, all of these are there. And they keep coming and going. Praneshu anavartam vartamana. As long as your path is given reality, there is no way of escaping them, and therefore, ceaselessly, and in an unbroken chain of succession, they keep on arising. Ahoratra adivata. Just as day and night keep on rising, you know, in unbroken succession. Samudravam vachya, or one after the other, just as the waves of some ocean, they keep coming. Similarly also, in ignorant people, this keep on coming, one after the other. You become free from one, the other one comes. Deal with the hunger and the thirst comes. Deal with that and then the grief comes. And deal with that, delusion comes. Deal with that, the old age comes. Deal with that, something else comes. And thus they keep on coming, one after the other. We keep on dealing with one after the other. Now there is a headache, then I do something else, and then comes the stomach ache, something else, and then, you know, ache in the knees, and thus they keep on coming one after the other. Not that we should not do something about it. The idea is that there is no end to that also. While doing something, we should also be looking out for that, you know, knowing which all this doing ultimately will come to an end. Otherwise, keep on doing things. Samudravam vachya, ahoratradi vachya. Praneshu samsara iti uchyate. And so, the taking oneself to be endowed with hunger and thirst, that is called samsara. Poor fellow then tries to become free from hunger and thirst, and that's the problem. And so, he first of all takes himself to be possessed of hunger and thirst, and then wants to become free from that. He takes himself as deluded and grieving, and wants to become free from that. He first assumes that, and then fights with it. Fighting with something which is non-existent. Like Don Quixote, fighting with the shadows and things like that, you know. And so, fighting with shadows. That's what everybody does, fighting with the shadows. And therefore, the shadows are due to something else. They keep on coming. You know, like this traffic goes on this road, shadows keep on coming, you know. On the wall you see Chitrapata, you know, it's just a movie going on constantly. And so, keep doing things. And they keep coming up. We should do that thing anyway. I mean, after what else shall we do? But the thing is that just doing that is not enough. That's the idea. Yosau drishtehe drishta ityadi lakshanah sakshat avyavahitah aparokshat agunah sravantah atma brahma ristama pariyantanam bhutanam asanayadi pipasadavihi samsadhani sadharana svashyade akashiva ghanadimulehi tamitam atmanam viditva. On the other hand, this is atma, which has been now unfolded in these two prashnas. Drishtehe drishta. Na drishtehe drishtaram pashyehe. That drishtehe drishta. One who is the seer of the sight, meaning one who illumines the sight. One who illumines all these, the perceptions. Sakshat avihitah, sakshat aparokshat brahma, sarvantara, brahmadistam pariyantanam bhutanam. So, atma, the one that is self of all the beings, beginning of brahma, all the way up to the pipilika, to the end. Asanaya vipasadavihi samsadharmahi sadanas pushyave. And that, in spite of presiding over this whole business of asanaya vipasa, the thing is, that who is presiding over this phenomena of asanaya vipasa, jara mrityu shokamo atma? Upadrashta anumantacha upadrashta. He is the closest witness. Anumantacha, let them be there, what they are. Let's not oppose anything. Bharta, Bhokta, in fact he is apparently the witness of everything, experience of everything, supporting everything, and still being untouched by everything. Asanaya pipasadivihi samsaradharmahi sadanaspushyade akashaiva ghanadimunaihi tametam vai vai atmanam svam tattvam viditva. Atmanam being svam tattvam. Tametam vai atmanam, etam vai tam atmanam viditva. Knowing that atma meaning, knowing that as one's own self. Jnātvā ayam aham asmi param brahma sadā sarva samsāra vinirvaktam nitya truptam iti. So idea is sarva samsara vinirmuktam. Free from all the samsara meaning what? Nitya truptam. It is ever contented, it is ever full, ever complete. So knowing oneself is ever complete, ever satisfied, self-sufficient. Seeking sufficiency outside of myself is always going to be samsara. And discovering sufficiency within myself is paramartha. So this is called, there is a difference between what we call the materialistic approach and the spiritual approach to the life. The materialistic approach is seeking sufficiency from matter, from something outside of me. And what we call the spiritual approach is seeking to discover that sufficiency from myself. Unfortunately, these two pursuits are contradictory to each other. One cannot do these two simultaneously. That is, one cannot be pursuing the sufficiency from the matter, at the same time pursuing it from the self. Therefore, it is necessary to give up that pursuit of seeking sufficiency from the matter, which is what is meant as becoming free from the various eshanas or the desires. By Viveka. Vittaya vaiparityena uttanam gatva. Growing out of this. Kutaha vittaya. Arising from what? Putreshanayaha. From the putreshana. From the eshana for putra. Assuming that eshana for putra means only the eshana for this loka. This is purely academic, or it is purely the Vedic or the Upanishadic viewpoint. That one wants sun purely for ayam loka, this world. One wants wealth for the pitraloka and swargaloka. People may want these things for other reasons also, But anyway, so even then, even if one wants sun for a different reason, it is ayam loka. What can the sun do? He can give me security in this world. That's fine. So ayam loka jayaha putrena, ayam loka jayaha. In short, seeking security in this world. And putra, vitta, all of them become means of gaining security in this world. Vittaya. Vyaparityena utthanam kritva. Eshana pratikulyena nirvyaparataya avasthanam kritva. Eshanas may arise, but then I do not give reality to that. And therefore, I do not succumb to this pressure of the eshanas. And so, nirvyaparataya avasthanam kritva. I do not do any vyapara to fulfill the eshanas. I may be doing vyapara all right, but no vyapara or activity to fulfill the eshanas. Because that will keep me busy, then I cannot do the vyapara for atma jnanam. And that being the case, that other vyapara has to go. Putreshanayaha, vittreshanayasya, lokeshanayasya, vittaya. Then Bhashyakara explains, yaheva putreshana sa vittreshana, that eshanas are not really different from one another. Uvehyete eshaneva bhavataha, one is sadhana eshana, other is the sadhyeshana. We said loka is the sadhya, and putra vitta is the sadhanam. So sadhya sadhane rupa eshana. So page 806, having grown out of these eshanas, etam vaitam atmanam viditva brahmanaha putreshanayasya vitteshanayasya lokeshanayasya vitthaya. This is supposed to be a statement called bhutarthavada. Upanishad says this is what the earlier brahmanas did. Although it looks like it is a description of the present, but it's to be understood as what the earlier brahmanas did. So Vashyakara says on this page 806, ataha yatikrantaha brahmanaha saram karma sadhanam cha saram devapitru manusa nimittam yajnopavitadi. Then what? Then he got stuck up there, And so, the earlier brahmanas gave up all this sadhanam. As you say, two eshanas are there. One is eshana for the loka, which is the sadhya eshana. Other eshana for putra vitta, which is the sadhana eshana. And we require vitta for karma. Vitta, the wealth is required for performance of the rituals, because without that you can't perform rituals. So we require two kinds of wealth, the material wealth and the divine wealth in terms of the meditation. So both of them are required to perform the karma and the upasana to attain the pitraloka and or swargaloka. Now Bhashyakara says that when this ascertainment has happened, that I do not want that swargaloka, and I do not want that pitraloka, I do not want this prithviloka, not because there is something wrong with them, But they cannot give me what I am seeking, that's all. When this clarity has come, then they are fine for what they are, and let everybody have them also, but that I do not, they cannot give me what I am seeking. What I am seeking is the total self-sufficiency, and that they do not have the capability of giving me that, when that is ascertained, then naturally karma also is given up, because karma is the means of Pitruloka or Swargaloka. When karma is to be given up, all that is required for perform the karma, the ritual also is to be given up, and Yajnopavita Adi is one. Yajnopavita, Shikha, etc. They are also the things that are required for Vedic rituals. So to qualify for the study of the Veda and perform Vedic rituals, it is necessary to have Yajnopavita and Shikha, all of this is required. So Bhashyakara spends quite some time here to establish that when Upanishad says here, that all the Aishanas are given up, the idea is that all karma also is given up. Tasmat brahma vidaha nasti karma, karma sadhanam va. Because what is it that actually prompts the karma or the action? It is desire that prompts the action. So without prayojana, without a purpose to be achieved, nobody can perform any action. And therefore, when the very motivation goes away, when the very desire, which is what motivates the action, when that desire is no more there, then action cannot be performed. So Vashyakara says that for Brahmavit, meaning even the one who knows Brahman indirectly, Parokshataya, even then when his prayojana jnanam is that Brahman is such and such, asanayadi sarva samsara dharma rahitam, Brahma asti, and that Brahman alone, I am ahasmi, that Brahman I am, when that also is clearly understood, then one realizes that the achievement has no more any role in my life. And therefore the Aishanas or the desires also have no standing at all, because Aishana is necessarily for something that I do not have. And now that I am seeking something that is myself, there is no question of Aishana or, I mean, the desire for seeking something other than me. And so all the efforts required to achieve things other than me, those efforts also have no place. And so whatever I needed to perform those efforts, after all now that I am retired and I don't need to go to work, but I don't need car also. Formerly I had a motor car so that I could travel from my place to the workplace. Now when I don't have to go to work, I don't require that thing. So when I retire, then I may as well dispose of the car because I don't require it. Or when I retire, or when I go to, for example, when I retire now and that I don't have to go to work anymore, I may have no use for all these neckties and stuff like that, because now where am I going to use that? Things like that. So when the phase of life changes, what do you do with those things? Then you dispose of all, whatever it is. There's no need in point in keeping it. Then there's no point in showing people, hey, look at what I had in the past. What's the big deal about it? So that all goes away, along with whatever. And so when karma goes away, karma sadhanam automatically goes away. So Bhashyakara says that for the one who knows Brahman is the self, even parokshataya, even intellectually. And as long as the intellectual conviction is firm, when it is there, then naturally the Aishanas cannot stand in light of that conviction, and therefore whatever was required to fulfill the Aishanas also cannot be there. So tasmat brahmavidaha nasti karma, karma sadhanam va. For a brahmavid, meaning for the one who knows Brahman indirectly, karma is not there, karma sadhanam also is not there. And this is what, that is why the brahmana, so when Upanishad says, so Aishana yaha vithaya, going out of Aishana, this to be understood is what? Giving up the karma and karma sadhana. This is, Vashyakara extends the statement. Actually what Upanishad says in so many words is in fact growing out of the Aishanas. Vashyakara says that nature requires that one takes up sannyasa. Sannyasa giving up any other means of security is all given up also. And so Vashyakara says, ataha yati krantaha brahmanaha sarvam karma sasadhanam karma sadhanam chasram dev pitrumanus namittam yajnopavitadi. So what is it? Yajnopavitadi yati krantaha. So yajnopavitadi nasti. Tasmat brahmanaha brahmavidaha vithaya karma bhya karma sadhanam bhya. So the yajnopavitadi, so tyaktva, that's all you can say, So giving up all that. So tasmat purve brahmanaha brahmavidaha
vithaya karma bhyam. Therefore, in the past, these brahmanas actually give up all the karma and karma sadhanam, including all these yajnopavitadi. And paramahamsa parivrajyam pratipadya. And taking up a form of sannyasa, which is called paramahamsa parivrajyaka lakshana. Meaning, that is sannyasa where one does not keep any kind of a crutch at all. So, yajnopavita, shikha and danda, all of these are looked upon as some kind of crutches, which you keep them for accomplishing something. So, Vashyakara says, the kind of sannyasa that not only does Shruti enjoy in sannyasa, but enjoy in sannyasa of the nature of paramahamsa parivrajaka lakshana. So, number one, the whole long discussion is this vyutthanam here. So, vyutthaya asa bhikshacharyam charanti, when the Shruti says, it is the vidhi or enjoyment for sannyasa for the modern day brahmanas. Since the brahmanas of the past did this, therefore the present day brahmanas also should do that. And then this is a vidhi, not just a simple statement, not merely narthavada, vidhi meaning an enjoyment. So vithaya, vittishteyuhu, you have to actually convert this grammatically and say that brahmanas presently must actually grow out of this. And chareyuhu, bhikshacharyam, chareyuhu, they must actually do the bhikshacharam. Just whatever is required to sustain the body, because body is required to pursue the knowledge. The Smriti actually also described different kinds of sannyasas. So sannyasa is of different kinds. What is kuti taka, bahudaka, hamsa, paramahamsa? These different levels of sannyasa are there. And earlier kinds of sannyasa like kuti taka, etc., then they actually keep the yajnopavita and so forth because they still continue to perform certain rituals. Because those kind of sannyasa are opposite, they are taken for brahmaloka. Then sannyasa is to be taken for brahmaloka because when a sannyasi dies, goes to brahmaloka. And for that purpose, sannyasa was taken. But when you take a sannyasa as an ashrama, chaturtha ashrama, then whatever codes of conduct are there and stipulations are there have to be also followed. So people need to follow those stipulations so that they qualify for brahmaloka. So that kind of sannyasa is that giving all that, meaning giving up the ashrama for brahmaloka also. And long discussion is there, where Vashyakara shows that here the Shruti actually enjoins a sannyasa of the nature of paramahamsa, parivrajaka, and no less. There can be no more, but there is no less. Now there is another important point also Vashyakara discusses in between. On the page 809, second paragraph, apicha atmajnana paratvat sarvasyaha upanishadaha. That yes, other Shrutis also very clearly say that there is a sannyasa called paramahamsa parivrajaka lakshana. And so, yajnopavitam vedamsa sarvantad varjayet yatihi. The yati of the sannyasi must give up yajnopavita and veda dhyanam, everything. Meaning, give up all the idea of the duty. So that now there is no demand upon that person other than merely pursuit of knowledge. That's all the duty he has. So, Bhashyakara says not only that, but makes a very important point that if you really study all the Upanishads, then what do you find? All the Upanishads are totally devoted to revealing the knowledge of the Atma. That's all. The only reason Pravritti Upanishads have is to impart the Atma-jnanam or the self-knowledge. Thereby meaning that all the Upanishads enjoin self-knowledge. You see, after all, when all Upanishads are devoted to self-knowledge, that means that Upanishads enjoin self-knowledge for everybody. And that self-knowledge is possible only when there is sannyasa. So Vashyakara establishes the need of sannyasa in another way also, that in as much as all the Upanishads enjoin Atma-jnana, enjoin. Indirectly, the Upanishad doesn't say that you must pursue the Atma-jnana. I mean, the Atma-vare drashtavya, it says also. Atma-vare drashtavya, he maitrayi, Atma must be known. Katham dashtavya, shrotavya, mantavya, dhyasitavya. So that way you can look upon that as an enjoyment of the Atma. Or vijignyasitavya, Chandogya Upanishad says that one must actually
deliberate upon the Atma. One must seek to know the Atman. So in fact, we do find the statements of Upanishads where the Atma Jnanam is enjoined. That means that all the Upanishads are devoted to enjoining the knowledge of the Self. The Karma Kanda is devoted to enjoining the Karma, and Upanishads are all devoted to enjoining the Atma Jnanam. So that's what Bhashyakara says, Apicha Atma Jnana Pratvat Sarvasyaha Upanishadaha. Since all the Upanishad, the entire Upanishad in fact, so singular, Sarvasyaha Upanishadaha, entire Upanishad, this Upanishad here, the entire Upanishad, namely Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, is devoted to revealing the or unfolding the self-knowledge. Atma Jnana Paratvat, Paratva means what? Committed to. The entire Upanishad is committed to Atma Jnana. How Atma, Drashtavya, Shrotavya, Mantavya, Idhi, Prastutam, because that is how the discussion began. Atma must be known and it must be listened to and so forth. Such Atma eva, Sakshad Aparokshat Sarvantara, Ashanayadi Samsara Dhanavajita Iti Evam Vigneha. And that very Atma which was earlier presented as Drashtavya, Shrotavya, Mantavya, that very Atma is presented here as Sakshad Aparokshat Brahma Sarvantara. So when it is said Atma or a Drashtavya, Atma must be known, how should it be known? As Sarvantara, as Sakshat, Aparokshat, Brahma, Vigneha, Idi Tavat Prasiddham. This is something that is well known, well established here. Sarvahiyam Upanishad, Evam Parayati, and therefore the entire Brihadaranyaka Upanishad has, this is the main theme. There are other themes in the Upanishad also. All those other themes only serve the purpose of this main theme. The main theme of this Upanishad is Atma Jnanam. And there are Upasanas and there are many other things there. All of them are only meant directly or indirectly for this. Iti vidyantara sheshattvam tavannasti. So don't think that this Upanishad it serves any purpose other than revealing the self-knowledge. Athana svalha. Atma jnanasya kartavyatva atmavare dastavya, meaning dastavya. So, neither dastavya means what? One must see the Atma. That means atma jnanasya kartavyatva. Atma jnanam is presented as that which must be done. And what is the nature of the Atma? One is free from asanaya, pipasa, shoka, moha, jara, mrityu. That means Atma cannot be reached. Atma who is beyond all the attributes, or Atma that is beyond all the qualifications is an Atma that can be reached. So what can be reached by action is always something that is possessed of some characteristic or qualification. For example, I can reach something that is rich, something that is powerful, something that is wonderful, whatever. But here is Atma that is beyond all these attributes. So Atma therefore cannot be an object of acquiring. You can't acquire something that is beyond hunger and thirst, you know. And so therefore, since acquiring cannot be in case of Atma, therefore karma has no role with reference to Atma, so karma sadhanam also no role has with reference to Atma. In that sense also, Bhashyakara proves that sannyasa is the only means for attaining the Atma, Atma Jnanam. And that is what this Upanishad enjoins. So this is a very important vakya. Vithaya athaviksha chayam chand is an important statement which is looked upon as a statement enjoining sannyasa. Paramahamsa parivrajaka lakshana sannyasa. And therefore, page 811, the last line says, yajnyo pavitadi sadhanat tas sadhya nyascha karamabhya avidyavishatvat ishanarupatvatcha jihasita virupatvatcha vitthanam vidhichatameva. Therefore, yajnopavita adi sadhanat, all the sadhanams are yajnopavita, shikhadanda, etc. Tat sadhya vyascha karmabhya. And why do you want to retain yajnopavita, etc.? Because you can perform the rituals. So those sadhanas are also given up, the rituals also are given up. Avidya vishetvat, because all of them are the realm of ignorance. Eshanarupatvatcha, all of them are in the category of Eshana. The thing is that Bhashyakara explains about Eshana to include karma and karma sadhanam. This is important. When Upanishad says that one should grow out of Eshana, Bhashyakara says
that as long as Eshana is there, so long karma is going to be there, and as long as karma is there, karma sadhana must be there. So Eshana is to be given up, meaning karma also is to be given up, and karma sadhanam also is to be given up. Avidya vishetvat, Eshana rupatvacha, because all of these are in the realm of ignorance, as well as of the nature of Eshana. In short, Eshana alone, what is desire at one level, alone manifests as karma. Desire for karma. And the desire for karma manifests as a desire for acquiring karma sadhana. That I want to perform a certain action, therefore I must have these resources, let me procure them. So karma sadhana also comes. So first is the desire for loka. That results in desire for karma. That results in desire for karma sadhana. And then I can perform the karma. So when desire is to be given up, karma is to be given up naturally, because karma is a means of fulfilling desire. When karma is to be given up, all the sadhanas meant for fulfilling that karma also had to be given up. And therefore, avidya vishayatvat, ishana rupatvatcha, jihasitavya rupatvatcha, and then also jihasitavya rupatvatcha. Ishana is something that is to be jihasitavyam. Because vithaya, ishana must be given up. Ishana and atmajnanam cannot, pursuit of atmajnanam cannot go together. That's what Upanishad seems to believe. That I can pursue some other goals in my life and then pursue this atmajnanam. These two things cannot go together. Jihasitavya rupatvatcha, vithanam vidhitsitameva. And therefore, this vithanam, meaning this giving up or renunciation, is something that is enjoined. So this statement is looked upon as enjoyment of sannyasa. Then page 813, vitthaya bhikshacharam charanti dhyanena parivrajyam vidhiyate. So this is the conclusion. Vitthaya bhikshacharam charanti. Having grown out of all the desires, he becomes a wandering monk, becomes a mendicant. Iti parivrajyam vijayate. By the statement, parivrajyam, the sannyasa, renunciation is enjoined. That's all. Then of course, the Purupaksha says, okay, we accept that this is a statement of vidhi or enjoyment for sannyasa. But then, still, sannyasas are of different kind. What kind of sannyasa is enjoying? So Purupakshi says, maybe this is a sannyasa where still Yajnopavidadi must be retained. Give up all Eshanas, don't give Yajnopavidadi. You know, because Shruti, Smrutis talk of other kinds of sannyasa where Yajnopavidadi is to be retained. So Bhashyakara says that there is other form of sannyasa which is meant for Brahmaloka and other goal, other ends. And here, the sannyasa that the Upanishad enjoins is sannyasa specifically taken for atmajnanam. And therefore, no other linga is required, no linga at all. So that is the point that is made there. Then, bhikshacharyam, what does it mean? Why? All right. Atha bhikshacharyam charanti. Having taken the sannyasa, then the sannyasis, they lead a life of bhikshacharyam. They lead the life of mendicant. So again there is an enjoyment of bhikshacharyam. Bhikshacharanam, that they must necessarily beg the food, you know. Now whenever there is an enjoyment of any kriya, charanti the kriya, then there are always some stipulations of how to do that. Only once a day you must take bhiksha, and then only in so many houses, and so this kind and so forth. The moment an action is enjoined, then it's a Vaidic action, then you require Yajnopavidadi again, because to perform any Vaidic karma, Yajnopavidadi is required. This is another point. So Bhashyakara says that bhikshacharyam is enjoined all right here, is not really enjoined, because bhikshacharyam is something that will automatically happen. What is really enjoined is sannyasa. Bhikshacharanam is something that will automatically follow, because what will this fellow do? He will have to sustain his life. Now you say that give up everything. Then what am I going to do? You know, give up everything. All right. Then what? So automatically, in order to sustain or survive, bhikshacharanam will be required. So therefore Upanishad says that to sustain yourself, may you go for bhikshacharanam. That is allowed. That means that bhikshacharanam, or begging for bhiksha, can go along with the sannyasa, paramahamsa, parivrajika sannyasa. That's all that is meant there.
nothing more than that.
It's not that he has to attain something. What happens is, when you perform an action that is enjoined by the Vedas, then that very performed action brings some punya. And that's the reason why people perform the actions to earn the punya. And so will it not be that the sannyasi also now obliges Shruti by Bhikshacharanam, so he will attain punya? So he's not doing it for punya, he's doing it merely for sustenance of the body. Okay, I think the rest of the portion we'll quickly finish tomorrow and then take up the Brahma Sutra.
Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate Om Shanti 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 Shankaram Shankaracharyam Keshavam Badarayanam Sutra Bhashya Krutau Vande Bhagavantau Punah Punah Ishvaro Guru Ratmedi Murti Bheda Vibhagine Vyoma Vadvyapta Dehaya Dakshina Murtaye Namah Om Shanti 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 Hari Om Shri Gurubhyo Namah Hari Om
Etam Vaitam Atmanam Viditva Brahmanaha Uttreshanayascha Vittreshanayascha Lokeshanayascha Vithaya Asa Bhikshacharyam Charante. So, etam vai tamatmanam viritva. Etam tamatmanam viritva. Knowing the Atma such as that. And what's the nature of the Atma? Yaha shanaya vipase shokam moham jaram mrityu matyede. Etam atmanam viritva. So, knowing the Atma who is beyond the effects of hunger and thirst, grief and delusion, old age and death. So there is an Atma who is unaffected by this. So we know that old age and death are a matter of experience at the level of the body. Hunger and thirst are also experiences at the level of the prana. The grief and delusion also are experiences at the level of the mind. These are there. And in spite of their being there, Shruti says that Atma is beyond all of them. So knowing Atma such as that, knowing it even indirectly, knowing Atma is this. So far I thought that I was subject to grief and delusion and hunger and thirst and birth and death and whatever. Recognizing now from an exposure to the scriptures, so this is what we call the prayojikam jnanam. It is even paroksha jnanam, indirect knowledge, what you may call intellectual knowledge, but there is prayojikam jnanam. Even this understanding about the life, also prayojikam, that now sets all my priorities in a different way. All the priorities of life are determined by my perception or understanding of life, and now this new understanding comes that in fact Atma or the Self is beyond hunger and thirst, meaning beyond all limitations. It is ever free. It is what I am searching for. That's what is the nature of my own Self. And knowing that, that means that whatever I am searching for in life is not to be found elsewhere. Is something to be discovered as my very self is to be discovered. And therefore there is no scope for any asanas or any kind of desires now, in as much as the desire is a product of my understanding that what I am seeking is something away from me. So this is the kind of desire that is being talked about, not desire as such. I mean, there are desires also for sustaining the body. There is hunger and there is a desire to appease that hunger. There is thirst and there is desire to quench that thirst. So those desires are not opposed to desires for Brahma Vidya. The idea is that there is a desire for Brahma Vidya, there is a desire for knowledge. And those desires that are opposed to the desire for the knowledge of the Self. And so, whenever the mind is focused away, directed away from the Self, then that is an obstruction to the desire for the Self, for knowledge of the Self, and therefore, but there are certain desires like fulfilling hunger and thirst, etc. So they would not be opposed to the desire for knowledge, as much as these are all recurring things, and then they get appeased. So having discovered freedom from all the desires, recognizing that there is nothing to be desired. So this is a recognition of what it is that I am searching for in life. That's most important. And recognizing that what I am searching for is nothing but my own self, is something to be discovered as myself rather than something to be achieved or attained. And so with all kinds of desires which are categorized as putraishana, vittaishana and lokaishana. So Vashyakara explained, and Shruti also said that ubhayeshu eshana eva bhavatah. Two kinds of desires are there. One is a set of desires for what we call the goal or the end, and others are the desire for the means. And so, having grown out of these desires for the means and end, brahmana vithaya atha bhikshacharyam charanti, they take to the life of bhikshacharanam. That is just an anuvada of something that would happen anyway. Idea is that when one gives up all the possessions and everything, naturally for sustenance of one's life, it becomes necessary to do the bhikshacharanam, to beg the food, and so that is what they do. And as it was discussed earlier and yesterday also, that this is looked upon as an enjoyment of sannyasa. So Bhashyakara interprets this statement as Shruti prescribing for enjoying that sannyasa or renunciation must be there as a prerequisite for pursuit of knowledge. In short, that is a frame of mind. What we call sannyasa is a frame of mind that is most conducive for the pursuit of knowledge. Inasmuch as it is recognized that pursuit of knowledge requires a total commitment, because every other commitment is opposed to Atma, therefore. If there are commitments that are not opposed to each other or commitments that are compatible to each other, we can pursue them simultaneously. There is nothing wrong in them. However, if there is something which is opposed, you know, to the other one, then we have to drop one in favor of the other. Inasmuch as any other pursuit would be opposed to the pursuit of self-knowledge, therefore, mind must become free from every other demand. In that sense, it is said, sannyasa. So, why sannyasa is understood as a spirit or in the frame of mind, where the mind is totally free from any kind of an agenda. In Swami's language, there is no agenda at all. There is nothing to be accomplished in life other than knowing myself, other than knowledge. Knowing self means knowing everything. As it was said in earlier also, the knowing the Atma, one as well knows everything. And so knowledge is such, knowledge of the truth or knowledge of reality. So that has now become his priority. Then alone sannyasa really would become a blessing. Sannyasa would become a blessing when my priority is already changed. It is not that I take sannyasa and then work on my priorities, but then the priorities are changed by this what we call prayojika jnanam, or by this understanding, the intellectual understanding about the life, and where it is very clear that the only pursuit, only priority I have, or only agenda I have, is the self-knowledge. This is when sannyasa, Vashyakara believes that sannyasa becomes necessary. That means that now this person needs a way of life where he is free from every kind of a demand. Sannyasa means, what again Swami would say, that playing minimum roles or essentially no roles. In as much as a human being is constantly required to play a variety of roles depending upon the setup in which a person is. And so if a person is a part of a household setup, then there are roles such as mother and father and so forth and so on. And each one of the roles always has a demand upon the person. And as long as it is necessary to fulfill those demands, there will be no time or leisure to fulfill the demand for this knowledge of the self. That is why sannyas is a way of life wherein one does not play any role. That is, one is not required to play any role because there is no duty or responsibility. So it is really sannyasa renunciation from all the responsibility. And therefore also it is a renunciation from all the demands, as we said earlier. So when I have no responsibility, I have no privileges also. That means I have no rights also. So all rights are also given up, all responsibilities are also given up, and therefore nobody makes demand upon him. He doesn't make demand upon anyone, so this is sannyasa. So a non-demanding life, there is no demand upon him, at the same time he doesn't make any demand upon others. So this sannyasa, Bhashyakara believes, is necessary. And if one can have this frame of mind, even remaining in a given setup, then it is fine. It is possible for one to remain in a given setup and then enjoy this frame of mind, this fine. But that Vashyakara does not think is possible. In introduction of Aitreya Upanishad, the long discussion was there, whether a sannyasi can even stay in home, you know. Why not? Lots of arguments were there. And then Bhashyakara showed that even a desire to remain in the given setup itself shows a certain need or an attachment. And that being the case, he ultimately concluded that, which is a very strong position which Shankaracharya has, and we, since he becomes a pramanam, for us to understand the Upanishad, we have to respect what he says in as much as, so very emphatically, even subsequently his disciple Sumerant, also Sumerant, as emphatic as he is, but he's been very, very emphatic about this thing. That doesn't mean that one keeps taking, one takes sannyas or anything like that. It means that one shoots for this frame of mind, or this, what we call the growth at the emotional level. Means this kind of a growth at the emotional level, where one's mind becomes free from every demand, is required. And when I don't make any demand, automatically there will be no demand upon me also, generally speaking. Or then at least one has the freedom to pursue a way of life where one doesn't have to fulfill any demands. So then one, the demand, the self-demand now is the most important demand. So bhikshacharyam charanti parivrajyam vidhyate. And this is how, so on the page 813, it is said, vyutthaya bhikshacharyam charanti parivrajyam vidhyate, which means that the sannyasa is enjoined by the Shruti here. Okay, I think we went through all that. Now where are we here? We are actually in the page 817. Then what next? The first step. Tasmat brahmanah pandityam nirvidya balyane tishthaset balyam cha pandityam cha nirvidya atha munihi amaunam cha maunam cha nirvidya atha brahmanah. So now one has to become real brahmana. Brahma, he is already a brahmana. In as much as he is a contemplative person, so how many stages of brahmana is there? First stage of brahmana, where there is what we call the prayojika jnanam, there is an understanding, intellectual understanding. Then is the brahmana who is now a sannyasi, and now is committed to the pursuit of knowledge, the feet of the teacher. And now this brahmana has to become yet brahmana. In the real sense, so in the real sense, brahmana means brahmanishtha, one who abides in the knowledge of Brahman. That is the brahmana in the ultimate sense, the real sense. Or if not Brahman is understood as sannyasi, then he is a sannyasi. So that's how Lord Krishna teaches sannyasa in Bhagavad Gita, and sannyasa obtaining at different levels. That's how in Bhagavad Gita what is taught is a sannyasa. Karma yogi also is a sannyasi. So sannyasi cha yogi cha na niragnir na chakriya hai. It is not that one becomes sannyasi only when one gives up all the agni and the akriyas, but then one becomes a sannyasi, or one can be called sannyasi even when one performs karma or one's duties in the spirit of worship to the Lord. Wherein there is sannyasa or renunciation of any kind of a reward. So it's a demand-free life is what Lord Krishna is teaching, really. We can understand sannyasa ultimately is a freedom from all demands. First there is a freedom from demand because of understanding. Ultimately there is a freedom from demand spontaneously because no, there is no need for a demand. Atmaneva, atmana tushtaha. Ultimate sannyasi is the one who has discovered a total satisfaction from oneself, because that satisfaction is the nature of the self, but it's a process of discovery. And first discovery is at the intellectual level, when one recognizes that yes, it makes sense, the satisfaction I am searching for is my own self. So that also is a level of sannyasa. And before that, even in the day-to-day life also, there is a sannyasa involved, in as much as one performs one's duties. One fulfills demands upon oneself without making any demand, you know, in terms of rewards. So, first of all, giving up the demand for the rewards. That I do something and for that I should be rewarded. By reward we mean a personal gratification. By reward we don't mean karma phala, because whenever we perform karma, the karma phala is going to be there. Whenever we perform an action, there's always a goal and a purpose is there. We don't say that one has to perform action without any purpose. Action is always purposeful. But generally speaking, there are two purposes in action. When we perform an action, not only there's a purpose to be accomplished, like when I'm speaking right now, there's a purpose that these words will be heard and understood by everybody. So this is what we call the drashtafalam, meaning the evident result. So whenever we perform an action, there is an evident result. And it is for that result that the action is performed. But there is an adrashtafala also, that through this action I may be seeking a personal gratification. And so that gratification either the level of senses or the level of emotion or the level of ego, some kind of gratification also I am seeking. And it is that which is what Lord Krishna is talking about as attachment. So when Lord Krishna says give up the attachment to the karma phala, it doesn't mean we give up the karma phala because you can't give it up, but give up that need, you know, or the gratification that one is seeking through the result is what is to be given up. And so slowly and slowly giving up this need, I mean, you know, giving up the demand for gratification, because human being, every living being always demands gratification, requires also. And we don't say that give it up, but the idea is that in course of time we discover a freedom from that. That is what is called emotional maturity or growth in our life, where one slowly becomes free from the demand or need for gratification. And that happens that to the extent that gratification is discovered with one's own self, to that extent alone one can become free from that need of gratification. If there is no gratification within, there is no way I can become free from that need also. And so, but this is how, leading a certain way of life, leading a life which involves worship and giving, is conducive to discovery of that gratification within oneself. This is the idea. And anyway, so that is the first level of sannyasa. Second level of sannyasa is then giving up all the roles, what we call vividisha sannyasa, sannyasa taken for the pursuit of knowledge. And then he becomes now ultimate sannyasi, in the sense of being a brahmanishtha or one abiding in Brahman. So what is the process there is the final step on the page 807, yasmat purve brahmanaha etamatmanam asadana phala swabhavam viditva sarvasmat sadana phala swarupa ishana lakshana vitthaya bhikshacharyam charantisma. So it is said that this statement is interpreted as bhutarthavadam. So ishanayaha vitthaya asa bhikshacharyam charanti, it is actually a statement of present tense, charanti, that the brahmanas take to the life of bhikshacharan. But this is understood as the bhutarthavadam. This is how the brahmanas in the past did. Having grown out of every demand that they took the life of a mendicant. Since they did it, etam atmanam viditva, knowing the atma. Knowing atma of what kind? Asadana phraswabhavam viditva. Recognizing atma as there is neither sadhanam nor phalam. In technical language, atma is neither a means nor an end. So atma is that which presides over this whole phenomena of means and end, but that itself is free from the ideas of means and end. Knowing atma is that. Sarvasmat sadhana phala swarupat eshana lakshana vitthaya. And so there is no end to be achieved. When there is no end to be achieved, there is no means also required. And therefore, since atma is of the nature of the one that is beyond the end and means, therefore his life also is of the nature of that which is beyond the, or free from the means and end. The idea is that the lifestyle should be compatible to what I am searching for in life. Simple as that. So when I want to reach Himalayas, then my pursuit must be to take a transportation which takes me to north and not to south, or to any other direction. And so also when the priorities of life are clear, according to perception of life, then I must take up to a means that is compatible to what I am searching for. And so when one is searching for this knowledge of the self, one is searching for the gratification or the fulfillment from one's own self by the knowledge, then lifestyle should be conducive to that, and that lifestyle is called sannyasa. And now, inasmuch as atma is neither an end, because it's my own self, not to be achieved, nor a means, because it cannot become means of achievement of something else, therefore the life also is such as that is free from the ideas of end and means. That idea, that I want to achieve something. And for that I must acquire a certain, take up a certain means, the life that is free from these ideas of end and means. Vithaya, Vikshacharyam Charantisma. Since Brahmana of the past did this, it is impossible. Arthavada or Bhutarthavada means a statement of what happened in the past. So this is what happened. Therefore it can happen today also, or this is how it should happen. Drashtadrashtardham karma tatsadhanam te hitva. And so karma, tat sadhanam chaitva, giving up all the actions as well as the means required for fulfilling various actions. And so including a certain lifestyle which was required to perform actions. Then, tasmat, adyatvevi brahmanaha, brahmavit. So therefore, see this is what the brahmanas of the past did. Therefore the brahmana of the present, meaning the seeker today also. So brahmavit, brahmavit is apada brahmadashi. So now one who has what we call the paroksha jnanam. So this brahmana who starts with paroksha jnanam or an indirect knowledge or an intellectual knowledge. Panditya'm nirvidya, panditya'm panditabhavam, idadatma vijnanam panditya'm nirvidya. So first gaining the knowledge of a self through the process of what we call shravanam. So listening to the scriptures from the teacher. This is the first, that is called panditya'm. Panditya'm is interpreted as, translated as scholarship. But the real scholarship is the real gaining the insight or knowledge about the Atman. And that's what Vartikar explained in four stages as to how the knowledge of Mahavakya takes place, Tattvamasi, in four different stages. Chaturvidham jnanam shravanachyam panditya'm. So first is adhita sanga swadhyayasya tattvamadipada shravane tatshakti grahe prathamam padartha jnanam. First is exposing myself to the teaching, Tattvamasi, that thou art. Oh, so this is what I understand, that what I call dhava, the atma, is that Brahman. That's the first tube light, you know, that really that self is Brahman, padartha jnanam. Tata samanadigata padavachyatanam visheshana visheshatvena sambandha. Then I realize that tat and tvam really are identical, because tat is tvam. In what manner I do not know, but I realize that they are one, they enjoy the same adhikaranam. And so first the sambandha is what we call visheshana vishesha sambandha, that then the tat is qualified by tvam or tvam is qualified by tat, or in that is how they are connected to each other. Or that they are one. Tata virodha sfurta upa. How can Brahman be self? How can self be Brahman? Because self is limited in every way and Brahman is limitless, and therefore how can they be identical? So virodha sfurta. When that contradiction becomes evident to me in that statement, tattvamasi, viruddham sasya kartritvadehi dhastehi. And then dropping that, oh, the sense of limitation that I experience with reference to self is because I think that I am a karta or bhokta. Or that limitlessness that I know about Ishvara also is also at the level of upadhi. Never, the recognizing that the sense of smallness or sense of bigness, all of these is not at the level of the self, is at the level of upadhi or personality. Ittham padasamarthyat arthatrayajnanantaram vakyasya svarthabodhanam tatparanirdharanamidhi brahmatmani vedantanam shakti tatparanisharuvam chaturvidham jnanam shravanakhyam panditya'm. And then I realize that this identity of tat and tvam, of jiva and ishvara, is purely at the level of the consciousness, you know. At, so there is in me also something that is an abiding reality. Although I find myself as a constantly changing person or constantly in a state of flux. But even the flux that I experience, now I am a doer, then I am an enjoyer, then I am happy, then I am unhappy. And this is what my understanding of myself is. But I realize that in all these constantly changing notions about the self also, there is an abiding reality that does not change. And that I always exist, that fact cannot be given up. That I am a conscious being, that fact cannot be given up. And that I always love. That love is always manifesting from myself every moment, that fact also cannot be denied. So there are certain undeniable facts about myself. That's all. Focusing attention there, that's all. That happy also I am, unhappy also I am, this and all the variety of things I am. But at the same time, that I always exist, that I always shine, and that I always love. Meaning, inside that, any action that I perform is always an action of expression of love, in some way or the other. Even when I hate also, that is also nothing but a distorted love, because there is something that I love. And when there is an obstacle to that process of love, then that very love gets distorted as hatred. But every moment what is manifesting from myself is existence. Every moment what is manifesting from myself is intelligence. Every moment what is manifesting from myself is love. Asti bhati priyam. So this is undeniable fact about myself. And that's the only fact about myself. Everything else about myself is subject to coming and going, and therefore that is not my nature. So this is how Vedanta enables us or makes us, look at the reality of our own self and then the reality of anything. Then I realize that the reality of anything, that really this and I are identical. Inasmuch as this also is an abiding reality, that this also is manifesting love all the time, this flower. Also manifests intelligence all the time and manifests existence all the time. Otherwise thing cannot exist, Unless there is love, a thing cannot exist. This poor flower also cannot exist unless it finds some fulfillment in being what it is. Everything finds a certain fulfillment in being what it is. It cannot exist. And it is always in it, because it also enjoys a place in the whole scheme of things, and so always functions in or acts or exists in an intelligent way. And so existence, intelligence, love is something that is manifest through everything. And that is the reality, that is Brahman, and that is the Self. So this is how one learns from the scriptures, that the abiding reality about everything and anything is nothing but Asti Bhadi Priyam, Asachit Ananda, and that is myself. This is Shravanam. So Panditim Nirvidya. Etat Atma Vijnanam Panditim Nirvidya. Etasya Atmaha Vijnanam. Etat meaning Samipavarti. So that Atma, who is the closer than the closest, so knowledge of the Self, that is evident. Nirvidya Nishesham Viditva. How long should Shravanam take place? Nirvidya Nishesham Viditva. Until this knowledge takes place, until then Shravanam should take place. Until then the Panditya has not been gained. So real Panditya is when this knowledge has been gained. That who am I? I am nothing but this Asti Bhati Priyam. And who is anything else? Also nothing but Asti Bhati Priyam. In different costumes, that's all. So every name and form or every personality, so this flower also has a personality, just as I have a personality. And then the difference is at the level of personality, but the person who is the essence is one. This knowledge is the result of Shravanam. This is called Panditya. And until this knowledge takes place, one continues his pursuit of study of the scriptures, contemplation upon the scriptures. Atma Vijnanam Nirvashesham Kritva Ityartha. There is no avashesha remaining, in the sense that nothing remains now in my knowledge, as far as discovering this truth. That's called nirvidya. Acharyatah agamatascha. How does it happen? Acharyatah agamatascha. From the teacher and from the scriptures, gaining this panditya or gaining this scholarship. So gaining this true understanding about life by listening to the scriptures, this process is called Shravanam. And when is that possible? When does this Shravanam, or when does the listening to the scriptures also becomes, really effective? Eshanabhya Vithaya. When one has grown out of all the Eshanas. Eshanavithana Vasanam Yohitat Panditya. That Panditya, or the real understanding, can take place when there is no agenda. Eshana means mind is always, Ishana means a desire, so mind is always working for something. And that mind which has a certain objective will always use anything as a means of that objective, in the sense that if there is something that I want to achieve in my life, then even studying the scriptures also will become means of that. Because mind always stealthily works for accomplishing what is most valuable to that. So I will have a desire for something that I look upon as valuable. When the Atma is looked upon or known as the most valuable, then alone the desires for other things will go. Otherwise, as long as something is valuable in my life, so long mind always will scheme, will scheme to accomplish that which is valuable, and everything else will become, including worship of God, also become means of achieving that. This is how the mind always works. That is how discovering a freedom from every other desire is discovering Atma, the Self, or God is the most valuable thing in life. Eshana vitthana avasanam evahi tat panditya. And so, idea is that only when there is eshana vitthanam, one has become free from the eshanas, so mahatva buddhi has slowly and slowly gone away. The person looks upon many things as important, but when he analyzes the nature of everything, then we realize that the importance is something superimposed by me, that a thing does not have importance inherent to it, rather than it is I who impose the importance to that, and not that importance is inherent nature of anything. So when I realize that, it no more remains important to me. If it does remain important to me, I must do something about it. It cannot be that something is important, and I just neglect it, you know. That doesn't work, and it should not be. If something is important to me, and I cannot become free from the idea of the importance to that, then I am required to pursue it. Because on one hand, the mind continues to look upon that as important. On the other hand, I try to brush it off from my mind. That kind of a conflict, you know, will always be there. That won't work. Then it is better that I do whatever is required to achieve that and discover whether it is important or not. So certain things have to be discovered only from experience. Certain things I can understand. And if my understanding is adequate to become free from the fascination for everything, no problem. But if understanding is not adequate, then sometimes it becomes necessary to actually experience the thing. And then discover what it is. But in short, that is how mahatva buddhi, as long as the mind looks upon anything as mahatvam or as important, so long the mind will want it. And this discovering of that importance is something that is superimposed by me, and that nothing in the world is inherently in importance, so that discovery is called so vitthanam. Eshana vitthana avasanam eva hi tat panditya. Eshana atiraskarod bhavatvat. Eshana tiraskarod bhavatvat. Eshana vriddhatvat. Because self-knowledge can arise only when eshana tiraskara is there, or eshana vriddhatvat has been discussed earlier here itself, as to how the desire for the self, it cannot be there as long as other desires are there. So eshana viruddhatvat. And then the self-knowledge can arise only when there is tiraskara or when there is the giving up of all other eshanas. Therefore Bhashyakara says that this panditya or that shravanam or listening to the scripture, that whole process really fulfills itself or becomes effective when the mind becomes free from the eshanas, the desires. Of course, one thing is there, that this very process of exposing the scriptures will enable me to become free from eshanas. That's what the scriptures also do. They analyze the various pursuits in life and then analyze and see them for what they are. So even this process of shravana in itself is absolutely required for me to understand the scheme of life and become free from those eshanas or desires. But that has to happen. Eshana matiraskritya nahi atma vishyasya panditya se udhava hai di. So atma vishyasya panditya se